in defense of punts, right? So this article is about punts, right? I am a big fan of punts. Naturally, I'm not able to create a lot of punts, but I am someone who relishes the idea of punts. So what is a punt and all of that we will discuss in this article. The author has discussed a lot of this. So let us start off. Once upon a time in 382 CE, CE is common era to be exact, Eve bit into an apple. Sounds fishy. 382 CE, why Adam and Eve? We don't know a specific timeline when that happened. So 382, okay, let's figure that out. Seeing it was good, she offered the apple to Adam and he also took a bite. Whereupon, Adam and Eve's eyes were opened and they realized they were naked. Ashamed at having broken God's sole commandment not to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, Adam and Eve hid themselves when he came walking in the garden. And the rest, of course, is history. I hope you all know the basic one-liner of Adam and Eve's story. God, in his wrath, decreed that henceforth man must earn his daily bread by working the earth and woman must suffer agony in childbirth. As a final punishment, he cast Eve and Adam forever out of Eden. Eden is the Eden garden, where not the cricket ground, of course, but Eden is the paradise kind of garden kind of thing where you did not have to work, but you got all that you needed, right? Prior to the 4th century, so 382 and 4th century, somewhere related. Okay, let us get there. However, no one knew exactly which forbidden fruit Eve and Adam ate. Genesis records only that the tree of knowledge of good and evil was off limits and it does not specify what edible flower that tree produced. Apples appeared in 382 because that's when Pope Damasus I asked Saint Jerome to translate the old Latin Bible into the simpler Latin Vulgate, which became the definitive edition of the text of next 1,000 years. Vulgate is a version of Bible in Latin which is supposed to be the original form. In the Vulgate, the adjectival form of evil, malus, in mal is malum. You must have heard of the word maleficent or the one that appears in the cartoons. Malus is evil. Also happens to be the word for apple. The similarity between malum evil and malum apple prompted Saint Jerome to pick up that word to describe what Eve and Adam ate, thereby ushering sin into the world. Which now we know why in 382 Eve bit into an apple. Before that, she bit into a fruit. In 382, somebody had thought of a pun and then said, hey, the word evil also is the same as the word apple. Let me put that together, put two and two together, right? The truth is though, the apple is innocent and this unjustly maligned fruit association with original sin comes down to nothing more than a pun. Punts straddle that happy fault where sound and sense collide. So they are trying to define what is a pun. Happy fault, it's a nice mistake to have, where sound and sense collide, where surface similarities of spelling or pronunciation meet above conflicting seams of meaning. So they are saying, on the surface, it sounds similar. It's common, very similar spelling and all of that. But something has conflicting seams of meaning, two different meanings, but sounds very similar. By grafting the idea of evil onto the word for apple, Saint Jerome ensured that every time we recall Adam and Eve's fateful disobedience in the garden, we are reminded of the fruit of a delicious tree of the rose family. From the beginning, punning has been considered the lowest form of wit, a painful fall from conversational grace. I wouldn't agree. I think the author also does not agree. What other form of speech is so widely reviled that we must immediately apologize for using it? Sorry, no pun intended. Right? So, it is in some sense people think that pun is bad, lowest form of wit, but it is not so. Puns do not deserve such a bitter appellation. Appellation is branding, if you may. It's a naming, giving a name. Right? It's not bitter. Despite its bad reputation, punning is in fact among the highest displays of wit. Indeed, puns point to the essence of all true wit, the ability to hold in the mind two different ideas about the same thing at the same time. And the pun's primacy is demonstrated by its strategic use in the oldest sacred stories, texts and myths. So in some sense, author says, hey, we have all been saying puns are very poor. It is a fall or a disgrace from what you call as a conversational grace and all of that. But he goes on to say that is not true. Pun is actually beautiful, wonderful. It is one of the highest form of wit is what he is conveying. The Bible is replete with puns, even without Saint Jerome's help. Saint Jerome is the one who translated evil into apple or made that pun. God fashioned Adam from Adama, biblical Hebrew for earth. Right? We saw that Adam was banished to work on the earth, which means agriculture and everything. So his name is a pun for earth. Eve's ancient Hebrew name is Hava, derived from Ahava, which means longing or love, but is also related to the words craving, mischief, and calamity. Punning was even present in the foundation of the Christian faith itself, when Jesus famously said he intended to build his church upon Peter, whose name in Aramaic and in Greek means rock. If you have read Da Vinci Code, you will find this idea as well, where they talk about built on the rock. I guess a Pope, Alexander Pope's verse they take and then they run about finding what it means. Built on the rock, but the rock is Peter. So in one sense Peter, but in the other sense it is built on a rock. Right? In Egyptian mythology, the human race sprang from the sun god Ra's tears. Though written differently, the words for people and tears had the same pronunciation in ancient Egyptian. So now he is going on saying about different cultures where pun was available. Right? The opening verses of the Indian epic, the Ramayana, condemn a hunter who fells a beautiful crane with an arrow, but the same words can also be construed as praising the Hindu god Vishnu for felling the demon Ravana. And the classic Chinese philosophical text, Tao Te Ching, begins with a triple pun. The way that can be talked about is not the constant way. So in three different places, in actual original context, it is called as Tao, but Tao has three different meanings in one sentence. Right? Punning folds a double knowledge into words. Right? To make and understand a pun, you must grasp two things at once, the primary apparently intended import of a word or phrase, and the secondary usually subversive one, something that is slightly not over the top, not really visible, which is what you are going to start with. Okay, let's start the other paragraph. The frisson in the ship's captain replied to the first class passenger. Frisson is excitement and fear somewhere thereabouts. Of first class passenger who asks if he can decide for himself whether to help row the lifeboat. The first passenger asks, hey, can I help row the lifeboat? Of course, sir, either or. It's a beautiful pun. Or is the paddle that you row. Right? He says either row or else. So it is in some sense lies in the friction between explicit instruction and implicit threat. So there is an explicit instruction. He says either or. Either or. There is a wordplay as well. It's called either or either or. So there is a wordplay there. So he says go for it. Go ahead. Do it. Also there is an implicit threat where either or either you or something else will happen. It's an untold thing available. Right? So it's a beautiful point. The brilliance of the tagline of the upstate New York town, known for its ravines and waterfalls, Ithaca is gorgeous, lies in the simultaneous statement of geologic fact and natural beauty. Gorgeous is beauty. Gorgeous is similar to ravines and valleys and waterfalls. Right? So they have used a beautiful word pun there. The best puns have more to do with philosophy than with being funny. Playing with words is playing with ideas, and a likeness between the two different terms suggests a likeness between their reference too. So they are saying playing with words is playing with ideas, and it has more to do with philosophy than just being funny. So pun is not just fun, it has also in depth something there which we have to figure. Puns are therefore not mere linguistic coincidences, but evidence and expression of a hidden connection between mind and material, ideas and things, knowing and nomenclature. So he says, not just coincidence, but somebody at some point of time when they thought about something, also thought about something that is not really related to that thing, but there was something common in terms of your nomenclature or how something sounds. punts are pins on the map tracing the path from word to word. Right. So, okay, let us take a small break and then, this is a very old pun. Why was 10 afraid of 7? And I'll give you the answer, obviously. 10 was afraid of 7 because 7, 8, 9. Right. Where are we all headed? And how are we headed there, wherever we are headed? I'll give you the answer for this after the next paragraph. Right? Not all puns need to reveal a concealed metaphysical truth. Some are simple homophonic homages. So, very similar in how it is pronounced is the only thing that is there. Which must be said aloud to be fully appreciated, such as, when you've seen one shopping center, you've seen a mall. You've seen them all, or you've seen a mall. When you've seen one shopping center, you've seen a mall. Seen a mall. A shopping center is a mall. That is where some things, it is just you expressing that and realizing, hey, this is there. Some puns offhandedly master the art of allusion, as in the description of contentment as the mother of invention. What is the original phrase? Mother of invention. Do you know what that is? Mother of invention? Necessity. Necessity is the mother of invention. So, necessity is wanting something. It's the mother of invention. Now, they have made a beautiful pun here where they say contentment. Contentment is I'm okay with it. I'm enough with it. I don't want something more. That is what contentment is. Contentment as the mother of invention. Mother is suffocating or in some sense killing of invention. Right, so very close wordplay. Some offer deviant definitions. Example, earthquake, a topographical error. This is wonderful. How is it? Because topography is something based on how the geography is. Error, you can also call error as fault. Whenever there is some fault happen in the tectonic plates, earthquake happens. So they have taken that and phrased it in a different way to create that pun. A topographical error is what is an earthquake. And some span more than one language, to wit, the characterization of an elegant Frankfurter as a hot dog, a form of wordplay known as macaronic, from the Latin macaronicus, meaning jumble or medley, of which puns about German sausage are generally considered the worst. So hot dog is a pun for German sausage versus a American hot dog. Yet even cheesy puns like these show how language is equivocal, two-faced, duplicitous. Duplicitous is having two different things. Many of the simplest and most common words sound duplicitous is also in some sense deception or deceiving or cheating. Not cheating per se, but deceiving. Many of the simplest and most common words sound the same but have equal and often opposite meanings. Fast means to move quickly. She can run fast, of course, I'll agree. As well as to be immobile. She was stuck fast. So, she was stuck fast means she is stuck. So, the one word fast can mean move quickly and to not move at all. Both the meaning of cleave, cohere, to split. The paddle cleaves the water with every stroke. The paddle splits the water. Right? The woodcutter cleaved the wood with the axe. And to cling, we cleave to hope even when all hope is gone. So it is something to split, but it is also to hold on to cling. Off conveys both activity and idleness. When the alarm went off, I realized I had forgotten to turn it off. So alarm going off is alarm running, the activity. Turn it off is make it idle, put it off, close it, finish it. When Alexander Pope said of puns, they speak twice as much by being split, is true of language as a whole too. So when you are splitting that, like you like a mall, you've seen a mall, right? You see that the language has two different meanings altogether, but there is just one word or a statement that is same. Right? In respect, puns pun for on human life, which itself equivocal, two-faced, duplicitous. Everything does double duty. Doors offer exit and entrances, which is true. Tears come from comedy and tragedy. Right? James Joyce had a painting of his father's hometown, Cork, Ireland. So, the hometown's name is Cork, framed in Cork and hung in his Paris apartment. So somebody took a painting of a place called Cork, framed it in Cork and then hung in his Paris apartment. A physical reminder of his notion of the world as a place where unexpected simultaneities are the rule. Words move into words, people into people, incident into incidents, like the ambiguities of a pun or a dream. According to Richard Ellman's biography of the author of Finnegan's Wake, a 600 plus page novel made up of almost entirely of macaronic puns. Macaronic is, how do you put it? Macaronic is too much in some sense. Or mixed, confused. Right? Okay, so before we start off with Shakespeare and Samuel Johnson, I'll give you the answer for that, for the question that I had asked. Right? Where are you all headed? You are all headed to IIMs. How are you all headed? Who are you headed with? You are headed with two IIMs. I'm like happy that I work in a company which has its name based out of a pun. Two IIM is just not number two and IIM. It is TWO, two IIM. But also to IIM, T-O-I-M, to IIM, on your way to IIM. Right? Likewise, we also had our founder, Bhaskar, had another company which has been rebranded into something called as Visaco. But previously, Visaco was called as 4GMAT, the number 4 and GMAT, or 4GMAT, another beautiful pun. I'm very happy knowing that. Right? Okay, so now we will enter into Shakespeare. Nor could Shakespeare himself resist a little quibble. Quibble is again a pun, as puns were known in his day. So in his day, puns were called as quibble. There are some 200 puns in Love's Labour Lost, 175 in Romeo and Juliet, 150 in each of Henry IV plays, and upwards of 100 in Much Ado About Nothing and All's Well That Ends Well. The average number of puns in a Shakespeare's play is 78. Wonderful. It was all a bit much for Samuel Johnson, who wrote the Bard's Relish for this form of wordplay. So, in some sense, let's say Samuel Johnson wrote a prelogue kind of thing for Bard. Bard is the poet, which is in this case Shakespeare. Right? If you think you don't know who Samuel Johnson is, I can tell you most of you would have seen Samuel Johnson's picture in some other context, maybe like a meme. Go Google, find out his picture, you know that, hey, this is Samuel Johnson, you will do that. Right? A quibble, which is a pun, is the golden apple. He says, Samuel Johnson says, a quibble is the golden apple for which he will means Shakespeare will always turn aside from his career or stoop from his elevation. So he will come down from his elevation or he will turn away from his career, but he will never miss a chance to make a pun. But what Johnson could not stomach about puns is the essence of their appeal as wit. So he did not think it was wit, but okay, we can agree to disagree, but that is what Samuel Johnson thought. In Act 1, Scene 4 of King Lear, okay, now they are getting into King Lear, I guess this is also written by Shakespeare, on how Shakespeare has used a pun. The fool taunts Lear, the king, for being, well, a fool for dividing his kingdom between his two deceitful daughters, which means in some sense cheating daughters, while disowning his upright third daughter. So he said, hey, I am disowning my third daughter, but my two deceitful cheating daughters, I will give my kingdom to. He asks Lear for an egg, for which he offers to pay the sum of 2 crowns. What do you think this 2 crowns is going to be? Is this 2 crowns, 2 of the crowns that the king wears? No, I think these 2 crowns is 2 coins. So he asks Lear for an egg. So he takes an egg and he offers to pay 2 coins for them. Right? What 2 crowns shall they be? Lear asks. Then the puns come trippingly from the fool's tongue. Having cut the egg and eaten the whites, the fool answers that he would offer Lear both halves of the yellow yolk, an image of the sundered royal headgear. So he says, hey, I will offer both half of the yellow yoke, which looks like your crown. He He then berates. Berates means kind of disses Lear for dividing his crown, his kingdom, and giving half to each of his conniving daughters. So in visual, in literal sense, he splits an egg and then says, hey, this is like your crown, and you are stupid enough to have given your crown to two of your daughters. Finally, he says, Lear was stupid to do what he did. Thou hadst little wit in thy bald crown when thou gavest thy golden one away. Here again, just beautifully says, Lear was stupid to do what he did. Thou is you. You had little wit in thy bald crown. It does not mean the crown or the thing that they wore, but their head. Bald crown is the head. So you had little of intelligence in your head when you gave thy golden one away. Again, it means two different things. When you gave your golden crown away, or when you gave away your, what do you call it, your daughter, which is not discussed here. I found one another way. So your golden crown is your good daughter, but upright daughter, you gave that away. In the other sense, it also means you gave your crown, which is crown, you can also mean as your, the place that you rule, the land is also called as crown. Right. So these are the meanings that discussed out of these three lines. In the short speech, the fool spins four puns from a single word. First, he pivots from crown, the coin, to crown, the monarch's headdress. Right, we discussed that. Then he plays off the resemblance between semicircle of a cloven or the cleave, split yoke, and the broken arc of the golden crown, a visual pun. Then he moves from crown, a physical object, to crown, a metaphor for the realm over which the king rules. And he tops it off all by calling Lear a bonehead and numbskull, skipping from crown as sovereign domain, which means about the crown as a country, to crown as empty patriarchal pate. Pate means head. So he says, your head is empty, you're brainless. The fool is not altogether a fool, and the pun is not merely a prankish word game. In stooping to employ the lowly quibble, again, this is in some sense Samuel Jackson's words. So, lowly quibbles. He says puns are lowly. Shakespeare elevates buried or forgotten sense of words, some showing how the names for things intertwine with the things themselves. When he turns inside, aside from Balder's statement to pursue that golden apple, he makes surprising correlations and uncanny couplings that keep the reader toggling back and forth between meanings, like how we did in the past paragraph. The puns are both launch pad and a landing strip for the fool's daring leaps of thought. It is a beautiful use of pun that has been mentioned in the last three paragraphs, taken from King Lear. And then the author has gone to explain how the fool uses so many different meanings out of just one word, crown. Right? In poem, words rhyme. In puns, ideas rhyme. This is the ultimate test of wittiness, keeping your balance even when you are of two minds. So in poems, the words rhyme. In puns, ideas rhyme. You take something, it sounds similar, but completely different things. That is how you create a pun. Okay. So now they have added a star, which means some other story is going to be starting. During a stint on the circuit court in Bloomington, Illinois, Abraham Lincoln had occasion to serve with prosecuting attorney Ward Lamon, a man of imposing physical strength who enjoyed challenging colleagues to friendly bouts of wrestling between sessions. So he was a lawyer. The prosecuting attorney was Ward Lamon. He was imposing physical strength. So he went to wrestling between your court sessions. One day while Lamon was wrestling an opponent near the courthouse, his exertions, which means his force, caused a profound rent in the seat of his pants, which means in some sense his pants tore. Being called at just that moment into court, Lamon was unable to redress the situation or effect repairs or make repairs. So when he rose to address the jury, his sartorial misfortune was readily apparent. Sartorial is something related to your clothing, tailoring and all of that. So his misfortune with the cloth was readily apparent. His pant was ripped apart. The other members of the bar who had full prospect, which means visibility, of Lamon's predicament from their chairs at a long table immediately to the rear of the prosecuting attorney drew up a subscription to raise funds for a new pair of trousers. So it was in some sense made in fun. They saw that the lawyer's pants are torn, so they said, hey, let us all create some funds so that we can gift him a new pair of trousers. They passed the paper down the line from lawyer to lawyer, each one signing his name and pledging some amount to cover Lamont's embarrassment. Again, this is also cover Lamont's embarrassment is again a pun. When the paper came before Lincoln, he quietly examined it. It picked up his pen, wrote his name, and under it a note of regret about his inability to render any pecuniary aid. Pecuniary is monetary aid. I can contribute nothing to the end in view. The end in view is the rear end of a person in view. Or end in view is what you see at the last, at towards getting him another pants. Lincoln loved puns. Strolling down Pennsylvania Avenue with the President, Secretary of State William H. Seward happened to note a sign bearing the name of one T.R. Strong. Ha! Lincoln cried. Tea are strong, but coffee are stronger. Again, he found tea and then he said, hey, I'll make this into a pun. Upon receiving a letter from a Catholic priest asking him to suspend the sentence of a man due to hang the next day. So somebody is about to be hung the next day. So a Catholic priest asked him, hey, can you please reduce the sentence? Lincoln observed, if I don't suspend it tonight, he is suspending the decision to hang somebody. The man will surely be suspended tomorrow. Suspended in air, hanging in air. Lincoln's wordplay offers admirable instruction in how wit actually works. Sigmund Freud shares. Okay, now from Lincoln, we are moving on to Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud shared Lincoln's fascination for punning and in jokes and their relation to the unconscious. He offers a pun from Heinrich Heine's The Baths of Lucca as a model for the mechanics of wit. So they are saying, so far they have only said about Sigmund Freud shares his fascination for puns, and even the name of the book is Jokes and Their Relation to the Unconscious. Okay, somewhere there is a name of the book which was related to some form of punning. I missed out. Okay, let us find that later. The Baths of Lucca as a model for the mechanics of wit. In the story, the humble Hamburg lottery agent Hirsch Hyacinth meets the famous Baron Rothschild and later boasts of how well the fabulously wealthy banker treated him. So person A meets person B and he is talking about how somebody, the person B, treated him. Just as if I were equal, his equal, quite familiar. Familiar is a term that we are not very sure of, right? The coining of the term familiar is a vivid example of the peculiar process of condensation and fusion. Freud believed characterized puns in particular and wit in general in condensing familiar from familiar and millionaire. Heine fused two definitions into new double meaning, a meaning all the more striking for having been distilled from such disparate sources. Disparate is completely different. So familiar is a term that was created by condensing two words, familiar and millionaire, and made to work. Right? All puns, including Lincoln's, operate in this way by bringing together two distinct sense of suspense, one legal and metaphorical, the other physical and literal. So legal and metaphorical is your suspend a stay up a decision. The physical and literal is suspending someone in air through the noose. Lincoln blended realms of understanding and interpretation that in convention thinking remains separate. Through deft juxtaposition, juxtaposition is overlapping of one thing over the above like this. Puns reveal previously unseen relation among things. This reordering of ordinary associations, this upsetting of the apple cart of expectations affords the mind sudden alternative points of views on subjects and situation it thought it knew. Right? Pardon the dogs, guys. So I cannot stop them from barking. So sorry about it. So what did they discuss in the previous paragraph? They are discussing about how something is in a legal sense and a metaphorical sense, but the other thing is a physical and literal sense, thinking about two different things in the same headspace. So he's saying he's wonderfully blended understanding and interpretation, and the conventional thinking remains separate. So the understanding of a word versus the conventional sense of the word are remaining separate, and you overlap it one on the other and then you find punch. The relationship between wit and knowledge is embedded in the word's etymology, derived from the Sanskrit verb vid, to perceive. Wit occurs in Latin as vider and in Greek as idein. So in some sense, they also spoke about this some time ago, where they said, hey, across languages also there is puns occurring. So this is one example of that. The German title of Freud's book on the subject is Der Witz. Okay, I thought I forgotten that, but it is coming later in the paragraph. Freud's book on the subject, wit and its relationship to the unconscious. So he thinks wit is a wonderful thing, and wit is the root of witan, is also similar to wisdom, from where wisdom is also taken. Terms such as outwit and quick-witted hint at the link between wit and knowing. So, outwit, you are wittier than somebody, quick-witted, you can think on your feet. It holds the link between wit and knowing, while dim-wit, nitwit, witless and unwitting hint at the link between wit and not knowing. We have our wits about us if we are street-smart, savvy or shrewd. We live by our wits when we devise impromptu solutions to sticky situations or evade seemingly inevitable consequences. So he is giving out different use of the same word wit. We can be scared out of our wits, and sadly we can also reach our wits end. If you are frustrated, it is your wits end. If you are scared, it is scared out of your wits. You are out of thoughts, you are out of wisdom, because you are super scared. So many ways of using the same word wit is there. The power of wit is to provide insight and information is precisely what Isaac Tuxton, a scholar otherwise lost to history, celebrated in the pages of Irish Monthly in 1877. Delighted surprise is the common immediate sensation following fresh knowledge of an elevated or curious kind, he wrote. Whenever resemblances or relations are established between ideas, knowledge of some kind is communicated. Wit establishes such relations. Knowledge shows us what the things are, how they are or how they might be, how things may be done and ends gained. Wit does the same, therefore wit is knowledge and communicates knowledge. So this is one person talking about how wit and knowledge are very close, similar, and why wit is knowledge and how does it communicate knowledge. Etymologically and physiologically, wit and wisdom are the same thing. Right? Now we are to the last part of this. Charles Lamb once remarked that, Charles Lamb is the name of the person, when the time came for him to leave this earth, his fondest wish would be to draw his last breath through a pipe and exhale it in a pun. So pipe is your cigar kind of thing, you use a pipe in which you use tobacco. Right? He wanted to inhale through a pipe the last breath and exhale it in a pun. And he was a prodigious punster, he is a wonderful punster. Once when a friend about to introduce the notoriously shy English essayist to a group of strangers, he asked him, promise Lamb not to be sheepish, he replied. I will, he replied. So Lamb is spoken to be sheepish. Lamb and sheep is the relation here, and then he replied, I will, which is in some sense a pun for I will. Lamb and his close friend Samuel Taylor Coleridge shared a passion for punning, not just as a fireside diversion, but as a model for the witty workings of the imaginative mind. All men who possess at once active fancy imagination and a philosophical spirit are prone to punning. Anybody who has active imagination and philosophical spirit, they are prone to punning, is what he says. Coleridge declared he planned a spirited defense of the widely impugned practice to be called an apology for paronomasia. The book Apology for Paronomasia is the Greek word for pun, drawn from beside the name, beside the meaning, the other thing for the same thing. Right? Coleridge considered punning an essentially poetic act, exhibiting sensitivity to the subtlest, most distant relationship, as well as acrobatic exercise of intelligence. So he says, it has to be very subtle, and it has to be through exercise of so much intelligence, connecting things formerly believed to be unconnected. So there are some two different things that are not actually connected, but you use your intelligence to connect them and make more sense. A ridiculous likeness leads to detection of a true analogy, is the way he explained it. The novelist and cultural critic Arthur Koestler picked up Coleridge's idea and used it as the basis for his theory of creativity. So now they have transitioned from puns to creativity. Right? Koestler regarded the pun, which he described as two strings of thought tied together by an acoustic knot. So he's tied by a knot, but the knot is acoustic. So based on how something sounds similar, how the word is similar, two different thoughts tied together. As among the power, most powerful proofs of bisociation. So what is bisociation? The process of discovering similarity in the dissimilar is bisociation. Right? So it is one more layer deeper than what a pun is. A pun, or indeed any instance of wit, compels us to perceive the situation in two self-consistent but incompatible frames of reference at the same time. Right? Like how Cork, Ireland versus Cork frame. So Cork is name of the place, but Cork is also the cork that you use to plug your bottles and everything. So this is how you use two separate but good things, not good but separate but correct things, but when put together it merges together. While this unusual condition lasts, the event is not, as normally the case, associated with a single frame of reference but bisociated with two. So in this case, it is associated with two different things. In some sense, it's also equivalent of cleaved, separated. For Koestler, the ability to simultaneously view a situation through multiple frames of reference is the source of all creative breakthroughs in science, the arts, and the humanities. So he says, okay, somebody has commented, there's one hell of a long passage. Yes, it is a long passage. For Koestler, the ability to simultaneously view a situation through multiple frames of reference is the source for all creative breakthroughs. So if somebody is able to view a situation with multiple frames of reference, for example, evil and apple, if somebody is able to look at a word and then think of two different things, then that is the source for creative breakthroughs, is what Koestler says. Isaac Newton was bisociating when he sat in contemplative mood in his garden. He watched an apple fall to the ground and understood it as both unremarkable fate of a piece of ripe fruit and a startling demonstration of the law of gravity. Paul Cezanne was bisociating. Paul Cezanne is a beautiful painter. Go look him up as well. Was bisociating when he depicted his astonishing apples both as naturalistic, meticulously arranged produce and as numinous otherworldly object that existed only in his pigments and brushstrokes. So his paintings, in some sense, look them as a naturalistic arranged produce or farm produce or apples. But in other sense, it is also a wonderful otherworldly thing. That is how it looked through his painting. Saint Jerome was bisociating when he alighted on malum as the perfect word to describe the actual fruit Adam and Eve ate, as well as their bad taste in partaking of the tree of knowledge of good and evil in the first place. There is no sharp boundary splitting the wit of the scientist, inventor, or improviser from that of the artist, the sage, or the jester. The creative experience moves seamlessly from the aha of scientific discovery to the ah of the aesthetic insight to the haha of the pun and the punchline. So he says the creative experience moves from scientific to aesthetic ha, and then haha of the pun and the punchline. Comic discovery is paradox stated, scientific discovery is paradox resolved. So comic discovery is when you accidentally find something happening, when two different things happen, right? But scientific discovery is when you resolve that paradox, is what bisociation is central to creative thought. Koestler believed because the conscious and unconscious processes underlying creativity are essentially combinatorial activities, the bringing together of previously separate areas of knowledge and experience. So bisociation is central to creative thought because what it does, the conscious and unconscious processes underlying the creativity are essentially combinatorial activities. So you have to bring together, previously you knew malum as evil, previously you knew malum as apple, now you had to bring and connect these two and make sure these two things are put together and works well in one place. This is precisely how wit was understood in the 16th and 17th century, when the word was used to describe innovative thinking, something more akin to intellect or consciousness rather than to glibness or flippancy. So it is not something just funny, but more of intellect or consciousness. Lately though, wit has been whittled down to a sliver of what really is. Now he's kind of sad where he says, now recently wit is only a sliver, a small part of what it actually was. Witty has come to mean merely funny, and wit is someone with a knack for snappy comebacks. true wit is richer, cannier, more riddling. Wit can be visual as well as verbal, physical as well as intellectual. There is the kinetic wit of physical comedians, the serendipitous wit of scientists, the crafty wit of inventors, the optical wit of artists, and the metaphysical wit of philosophers. So he says, hey, wit is available in so many different frame of references. Wit is the faculty of mind that integrates knowledge and experiences, fuses divided words, and links the like with the unlike. The pun is at once the most profound and the most pedestrian example of wit at work. Most profound is something mind-blowing. Most pedestrian is very common. Coleridge never did complete his planned apology, but Lamb did several essays on punning before he breathed his last, including one entitled "That the Worst Puns Are the Best," in which he vigorously defended paronomasia, arguing that pun is not bound by laws which limit nicer wit. It is a pistol let off at the ear, not a feather to tickle the intellect. He says, hey, pun is there. Pun is not bound by laws which limit nicer wit. It is not to be very correct and none of that. It is not bound by anything. Pun is somebody be able to relate two different things in a brilliant way and put them together and make somebody think about it. Let the pun be the starting gun for this renaissance of true wit. He says, this recovery of true wit, let pun be the starting point. It's a long article, guys. We've gone 45 minutes into this article. What do you mean by bisociating? You can Google for that. Bisociating is a in-depth form of pun, or deeper form of pun is what bisociating is. Right? So I really, really, really thoroughly enjoyed this article.